Here we go with the Rad Rodgers Kickstarter Beta. The retail game actually doesn't release until the end of Q1 or Q2 2017. I know they're still working on that. So anything you see in the game, any sort of issues you may see, just remember it's still beta. Now, I've got to say, being beta, it almost feels like a full commercial product the way it is. It feels pretty finished, or at least close to it. There are a few things I'll point out a little bit later where I could see improvement, but other than that, other than these little small details that I have, it seems pretty complete, and that's surprising considering a Kickstarter prototype is usually what I would expect, like an alpha or, something really rough around the edges, and this game is not. They've obviously been working on it for quite some time, and it's very well polished in its current state, considering the Kickstarter just ended a couple weeks ago. So anyway, Rad Rodgers is kind of a parody or mashup of early 90s or just 90s, late 80s PC platformer games with a bunch of inspiration from console platformers. And I'll go into detail about the platformers in a second. I mean, you're probably saying, well, what's the difference between console and a PC platformer, a 90s console and PC platformer? I'll cover that here in a minute. But the game really is just a parody mashup of those genres, of that genre. About a boy and his game system, basically, that comes to life in the game and it guides him throughout and acts as a weapon. The game system Rusty on his back that you can see right there. But back to the PC platformers. In the early 90s, if you were either on one side of the fence or the other, and if you're a lucky kid, you were on both sides of the fence. So you had your console games, your Super NES, your Sega Genesis, your Nintendo, your PlayStation stuff. This was kind of prior to that. So this would have been, right around the NES, Super NES, Sega Genesis era. Now, if you were lucky enough at the time to have what was called a IBM PC compatible or clone, which was a very famous term back then, or if you had both a PC and game console, or maybe perhaps your parents had one, then you were probably playing a lot of the PC-like equivalents of console platformers that a lot of developers and publishers were putting out on the PC. And these differed greatly than their console counterparts. The console games, the platformers, Mario, Sonic, Contra, just all sorts of stuff like that. I mean, I could go on Donkey Kong, anything like that. The list goes on, and you kind of pick up on how those games are going to be. Pretty much, you see it on the console, and you kind of assume that the next games are going to be kind of not exactly like that, but they're going to follow a similar pattern. The PC platformers, they had a very different tune to them. They had a very interesting style of art, a very interesting style of music. We didn't have conventional game... I mean, we did. We had stuff like the Gravis gamepad. But us PC gamers back then, we were pumping, 286s, 386s, 486s if you were really cool. But we were pumping that stuff out. We had the, everything was manual. You didn't have a console. The ease of just plugging in and starting a game. We had to configure this stuff through, DOS environments, or even before that, Commodore and Apple. The Apple IIs and stuff like that. But anyway, this focuses more on the PC platformers. So we were configuring this stuff through DOS, which was cumbersome at the time if you were a kid. Luckily, interesting enough, we did learn a lot from it. Now, most of my career and what I know about computing now has all been based from those many years of early PC gaming and figuring out all the IRQ settings, the Sound Blaster cards, how to get my Gravis gamepad connected and working, how to figure out, the networking protocols through DOS, HiMems.sys, AutoX.bat, Config.sys, There was just all of these things, even down the video, EVGA, or, you know, EVGA, VGA, CGA, monitor, you know, you had all these different video modes, all these things, and you're doing it in such constrained space. Back then, you know, you're lucky if your hard drive was, you know, 50, 60 megabytes, 100 megabytes, I think. even getting CD-ROM drives, if they, you know, if your machine even had it, running in DOS was cumbersome. But once you got the hang of it and you started figuring stuff out, everything, you know, everything ran smoothly. And your mighty, you know, 1 or 2 megs of RAM, if you were lucky enough to even have that. PC games were advancing so quick. I'm sorry, PC hardware was advancing so quick that games from 1991 to 1993 would look so radically different. Or even 1992 to 1993 would look radically different than they did the year prior. CPUs were, you know, getting faster, more RAM, just everything. And where on the console platformers, they were pretty much stuck on the same hardware for, you know, a decade at a time, so they didn't look radically different with each release. Not the case with the PC platformers. They all had their own unique look. There were so many variations. They had their own sound effects. You went from almost like 8-bit sound effects to 16-32-bit. To 16 and 32-bit style sound effects, you know, 8-bit graphics to 16-bit looks to 32-bit graphic detail, if you had Veezer drivers, and I mean, it was just on the brink of the whole, you know, first-person shooter 3D era, as soon as Wolfenstein and Doom came around the corner, is right about where these platformers started fading out on the PC. And the PC platformers of that era, there was just so many of them. In fact, I don't know if anybody remembers ever picking up a shareware copy of practically anything back then that was done by, you know, published by Apogee. Or back then, before the internet, there was the BBS services, and you could always browse the latest titles. But Apogee, who later branched into 3D Realms, which was one of the co-developers of this game, if you saw in the titles with Interceptor. They would put out this catalog on every shareware disk. It was just a text file, like an interactive text file, and you could scroll up and down and just kind of look at all these different games that they were releasing. And they, you know, they had dozens and dozens of games from id Software, from 3D Realms, from Apogee themselves. I think even Epic Mega Games. So, you know, you had Hocus Pocus, you had Crystal Cave, you had Commander Keen, you had Jazz Jackrabbit, probably a half a dozen others I'm forgetting. And they, between each one, they looked radically different. But you could always tell because they looked better than their console counterparts of that era. They were, you know, had just more advanced features, more options, more map area, more levels. They just had more characters. They weren't limited to the constraints of a cartridge or the ancient technology inside of an aging console. So they really stood out. And some of them may have been a little more generic, but they had a lot more detail to them, a lot more content to them. And, you know, you could modify them, and, you know, there's just all this stuff that you could do with them. And it really left an impression on us of that era. That we kind of mourn for, and we haven't seen. You know, we see these games come out today. A lot of these indie developers on Steam, you know, the indie green lights or early release, early access, and stuff. Yeah, they've tried to go back and, you know, recreate that same magic. And more often than not, they tend to fail to capture the same spirit that the games of that era had on the PC. Fortunately, that is absolutely not the case with Rad Rodgers. It also helps that they've had, you know, the industry leader, the 3D Realms, who has been there since that era, who was a huge part of that era with their parent company Apogee, helping out and assisting on this project. But the team at Interceptor, they have also done their homework, you know. They've been fans of this stuff for decades as well, and it is they've really put out something that just me. I played through this a few times already, just this 2-level demo that they put out for the Kickstarter, a 2-level beta, and it really captures that magic, that spirit, that soul that the 90s platformers had. And it does it so well, even on a modern engine today like Unreal 4, which is what the game's using. Now, generally, I know that, you know, a lot of these modern developers, they'll use these franchised engines or licensed engines because they're pre-built. And of course, the same with Rad Rodgers, it helps expedite the development process. You've already got an engine ready to use, so, you know, all you've got to do is just detail it and make it, tweak it the way that you want it for your own game. My only problem with that in the past was, especially during the Unreal 3 engine licensing era, which was, you know, for several years up until Unreal 4 was released, was games started to look a little too similar. You could always tell, like, oh, well, this is just another Unreal Engine game. Yeah, there wasn't enough to differentiate it between any other game. The titles just started to look too much the same and started to act too much the same. You came to learn what to expect from the engine. I've seen quite a bit of the Unreal 4 engine, and I've seen quite a bit of Unity. Unity also is starting to have that feel, too, where everything Unity anymore I see starts to have this all too familiar look and feel. But the Unreal 4 engine, for the most part, has been able to distinguish between titles. Like, you know, I could look at this game, and I don't know if it's the engine or the way how well they've done in developing it, but I'd say, well, this really looks like it's powered by its own thing. You know, this doesn't look like any other game out there. They have put a tremendous amount of effort into art and detail and design in this. And it just is juicy eye candy. And it's not just eye candy, but it's the same type of eye candy. I see bits and pieces of different 90s era games in this title, mixed in with games of even today, like Ori and the Blind Forest or Trine or, you know, Lucky's Tale, or, you know, there's so many others out there. But yeah, it definitely looks like it could be Commander Keen or Crystal Caves or JS Jackrabbit, but it also looks like it could be Mario, Sonic, but any modern game as well. They've done a real great job of making it feel fresh. But even despite the modern graphics overhaul, where it's, you know, very splashy, very lush design, and all the new engine features of sound, audio, everything like that, at its core, it is still a PC platformer, and that is the most important part, and that the part that they, you know, that they were most focused on, and they've done that. Even the audio is incredible. The music score is just phenomenal. You know, it sounds like a throwback, but it also sounds, you know, great in today's time. The soundtrack, you just riff, you know, guitar, it's just action, it's keeps you pumped. The actual sound effects, you know, it sounds, there's a lot of modern, you know, dialogue in there, but there's a lot of retro effects, even the modern dialogue and all the modern sound effects, but a lot of the 8-bit, 16-bit inspired sound effects, they all just seamlessly merge together in this. It's really incredible. And the, overall, the game feels old. I mean, it looks so modern, but it plays old, but not old in like a terrible way, but old in the way that we want it to the most. It is that PC platformer at heart, and it controls like that. It runs like that. Everything operates like that in the game. And it's not old, but it's old school, and it's just playing like something that we've been dire to have our hands on, begging to have our hands on for all these years, and it's like, ah, you guys got it. I really think that's something anybody of any age is going to really appreciate about the game. Even if you weren't from that era, I'm you know, you play through this, you're going to say, oh shit, maybe I should load up DOSBox, or, you know, go find an old 486 computer somewhere, install DOS, and play some of these classics that this is based on. And even if I was, you know, even being from that era, this makes me want to do the very same. It's like, oh yes, I can't wait for the final product. In the meantime, I'm going to keep playing this, and I'm going to go back and run through, you know, those old PC platformers again. I mean, it'll have an appeal to everybody of all ages today, but I mean, I think the people who are going to enjoy it the most are the ones who grew up in that era. It is very challenging. It's not an easy game. And it's very raw, just like the PC platformers used to be.
apologize to everybody for the in-depth analysis of the history of PC platforms and the origins of it all, but I think it's they've really built something special, and they took a lot of influence and inspiration from over the years with a lot of help from inside industry pros, or the insider pros of the industry, really piled it together here. So I'd like to highlight a few things from the games here as we just kind of watch along and react. Now, like I mentioned earlier, remember that this is in fact a beta of the game. Interestingly enough, there have been a few different beta releases. This one actually includes the October 29th beta release mixed in with the prior beta. I had to go back and edit in like the overland map area and a couple menu options and a couple other things. I don't show off the level that they had just added in the October 29th beta, but you do get a little bit of hint of some of the stuff that they've been adding through the betas throughout the video. It's probably also worth noting that the developer has obviously condensed this down for a beta. And in a way, I think they're kind of treating the beta, the Kickstarter backers, is almost like a shareware version. It's got a couple levels, there's only a select amount of weapons or characters or items in it to pick up. So what I may point out is saying, this could use improvement. Maybe it's already been fixed behind the scenes or was never an issue to begin with. It's just that they've limited it for the beta. Now, one of the things I really love about the game are the puzzles in the game, and they are, they're very challenging, and there's a lot of them. It takes a lot to get around the level, a lot of platforming, obviously, a lot of ropes, a lot of crawling, hand over hand, just a lot of thinking. More importantly would be like also the hidden secret areas, and there's a lot of them in each level, and they're not always obvious when you think that they would be. You could run right past them. Some of them are small entrances, some of them are hidden inside the walls. When you enter these areas, I think that there's like characters in them that give you items, like jewels, and I think at the current state they look pretty bland, but I'm pretty sure that there's going to be some backstory to these characters, and there's maybe going to be more to it when you enter these secret areas, so they'll be a little more lively and a little more animated. Those are obviously a throwback reference to many platformers and side-scrollers, especially the one that comes to mind immediately is Commander Keen. Yeah, there's a good variety of puzzles and hidden areas in the game, so definitely no shortage of that. One of the major puzzles of the game, and you saw it multiple times if you've been watching the video, is when you have to use your backpack console buddy, Dusty, who's extremely obnoxious and foul-mouthed, but very humorous, to fix game glitches for you. And I'm not talking about, actual real-world game glitches, but the developers have added as humor game glitches within the environment. So they're basically a black hole that sucks in, instead of light, it sucks in pixels. So you've seen them throughout the game already. If I get too close to them, the resolution of the game starts dropping and you can see them kind of picking in pixels. Well, anyway, Dusty will enter this area for you, and you gotta avoid obstacles and fight enemies in there to regain health in case you start to take damage. You have to navigate to the glitch, and in some cases there's multiple glitches, and I found that very challenging. Basically, once he restores the glitch, Rad Rodgers can continue on his path onto his next quest. Black hole pixel puzzle was just very unique and very noteworthy to me. I loved it. I thought it was a lot of fun, and I hope that they extend upon that in the final product. Also, the character Dusty, I think, is just phenomenally well developed. He's a great character. He's funny. Like I said, a little obnoxious, but the fact that he's voiced by John St. John, who anybody here doesn't know who that is, that's the same gentleman who does the voice for Duke Nukem, just makes him more humorous in a dirty old man sort of way, but a very faithful companion. Or as faithful as an imaginary video game console that's come to life could be, anyway. Speaking of Dusty, he also acts as one of your primary power attacks in the game. If things start to get a little rough or too many enemies and you're closed quarters, you can use Dusty to do like a power stomp with, or power smash with his fists, and it does incredible damage to anything around you. puts him up in a big juicy splat. As far as the other weapons go, right now we only have Rad Rodgers' like blaster pistol, which can be enhanced with various pickups or items around the game world. These provide your main character with a limited duration power-up, whether it be like a Gatling gun, a chain gun, or there was this one that shoots flaming eagles, that sets everything on fire. And those are a couple just in the beta that we're given, but I think there'll be many, many more, and they seem very effective and just as thrilling to fire. I mean, they're very fun to shoot. They're kind of, they make you bust out laughing at first at how much overkill they actually are, but they work incredibly well. My only gripe about some of the weapons isn't actually with the weapons themselves, but rather it seems like some of the enemies that we're faced with, or even like, you know, boxes that are stacked together, they seem to take an awful lot of firepower to take down. I'm thinking maybe that could be something that maybe they want to consider tweaking later down the road. No, I really do love the weapons effects. They boom, and you know, they're loud and devastating as they should be. Goes for the in-game explosions and effects, like the enemy jibs and full-body explosions. They did a really great job with that. The excessively gory detail is certainly appreciated. There can never be enough of it. All the items and checkpoints in the world all seem typical, and, except for the save icons. I love them. They're a throwback to the old 3.5-inch floppy disks. You know, anybody that did PC games back in the 90s, 80s, you know what a 3.5 floppy disk is. You know what sound they make, and that sure enough, the sound is there in the game. So that instantly put a smile on my face. Maybe the only thing that I would think to improve upon would be maybe more variation to the objects that you pick up. And that could just be a beta limitation too, where just for the size of the beta, they only added, you know, one type of gem. But yeah, I'd like to see more type of gems, especially like in this area right here. You know, that gem I see awful lot in these levels here. And maybe some character development on that character in that hidden room. Which brings me to another thing. I've only seen one type of real enemy. You know, there are, I think, one other enemy throughout these beta levels. But, again, that may be a limitation of the beta, just for size and constraints. Or maybe, you know, everything else is unfinished at this point. But would like to see more mixture of enemies and item types throughout each level. The game world is very alive. It's very fluid. It's very bouncy and speedy. It's very snappy too. Much like a lot of the modern day platformers and side-scrollers that have been coming out. But it's very classic in the sense the way the combat works and the control works. It almost feels like you're going back and playing like Super C or Duke Nukem or Commander Keen, especially when it comes to the platforming portion and the puzzles and the mini-games. It all seems so perfectly balanced between old and new. So the dynamics, the physics, and the mechanics are very modern. The gameplay and the control, along with the weapons and puzzles, are all classic. Another thing I would like to see is maybe some co-op or multiplayer experience added. I know that was one of the Kickstarter goals. I'm not sure if it was reached or not. Maybe they'll have a heart and go back and add that in if it wasn't. And maybe the possibility of additional weapons. I'm not sure if that blaster is probably not going to be the only weapon in the game. I know you do have your power-ups, but I like to see some varieties of different weapons too, not just power-ups for a single weapon. And Dusty. I think, I love the Dusty Punch, you know, but, maybe if there's, like, power-ups for Dusty or, like, super modes for Dusty's attacks, maybe, dare I say, glory kills for Dusty attacks, that would also be pretty cool. But that may be also going beyond the, you know, the scope of what the game's intended to be. Or it may already be added. You know, again, like I said, it's just a beta. These could be non-issues that they've already thought of, and they go, aha, that's already there, but you've got to wait to play. I'm also glad to see that they added the Overland map area selection screen. That is a huge throwback to mini platformers, where you gives a little sense of free roaming around from map level to map level. Kind of just fun to see, you know, your character walking around those areas. They added it in this beta, I was thinking about recommending that just a couple days ago while I was starting this recording, and here they went ahead and did that. So I guess that was something that was in high demand or that was there the entire time, and they're like, ah, yeah, you know, we should really put that in there because it's cool. So that's about it for now. That's about all I have to show you guys while I sit back and reap my Kickstarter rewards, official soundtracks, picture in the game and the credits, big box version. Oh, that's a whole nother discussion. Don't get me started on big box PC collections. But yeah, we Kickstarter, some of us get a big box PC version, and I cannot wait for that. I love the big box games. I wish they would come back as a thing.
There we go.
I know digital streaming has killed that off. I think they should give the streaming industry a big fuck you by not just releasing a big box version, but also releasing a 3.5-inch floppy disk version as well. I don't know how many floppy disks it would take to cover the game data. Thousands, probably. But hell, I would buy it, just for the fun of it. The developer is also very, very active and interested with everybody who kickstarted the game. So they've been reaching out to us, asking for feedback with polls. Certain Kickstarter backers, including myself, will also get to be on conference calls with the team to make recommendations for the game going forward. It is awesome to see them being very proactive with the community. I mean, they have a mega hit game here on their hands, I can tell you that right now. And, you know, they are constantly updating the beta for us. Like I said, it's almost near a final product. I think when it finally released in 2017, we're going to see a whole new era of these classic PC platformers. And this is just a tremendous throwback to that. And it definitely carries on a torch into a new generation. One last request before we say goodbye to everybody, and that is I request official Gravis gamepad support. I don't care how, I just want to see it in there. Rad Rodgers will be landing on a system near you in 2017. Until then, take care, everyone.